So here's the situation. Imagine you have 6,000 keywords in a campaign. How on earth do you begin to split those out and create a better campaign structure? This is what we're going to be testing this week and next week here on the podcast. So today I'm joined by Clement from Ad Badger. What's going on, Clement?
Hey, Michael. Thanks for having me.
Yes. This is another one of those case study episodes where we're really going and we're really testing things. We're talking about real accounts and real campaigns and real situations, talking about what we can do to fix things. So you might have 6,000 keywords in a campaign, dear listener, or you might have 500, or you might have 100, or even problems can arise even if you just have 10 keywords in a campaign sometimes. So campaign structure has been on everybody's mind this year, 2022. Fixing things like campaign structure is a great way to boost volume, to improve CPCs, to improve ACoS, to improve total ACoS, because you can fine-tune your campaigns a lot easier. So the thing here is, Clement, help us set the stage a little bit. So you just started working on a campaign a couple of weeks ago, and what we're doing with this episode, and part one, we are recording today on November 10th, and then next week on the show, we'll be recording like mid-December or so with the recap. So you, listener, will hear it right back to back. However, we're going to take a couple weeks to actually do the work we're going to be talking about. We're actually going to do a campaign restructure, measure the impact of it, hear from Clement about what he's thinking and how he's going to approach it. And then our next episode, which will be released right after this episode, however, we're recording it over a couple of weeks. This is convoluted, but it'll make sense when you listen to the next episode, because today's November 10th. We're going to set the stage. We have a new client. We have a new situation, new product to boost. We're going to talk about the product. We're going to talk about things that we're doing here to push it forward. So Clement, help us set the stage. It's November 10th. You've been getting to know the client, getting to know the industry. And as with all these episodes, we are going to anonymize everything. We're not going to mention the product. We're not going to mention the client. We're going to keep it totally private so that we can actually talk about the strategies that we're using and the data that's going into all this.
I've launched campaigns and picked keywords. I've got my bids, set placements too. Now bad mistakes, I've made a few. I've had my share of wrong keywords, but I've gone through. We are the PPC, then my friend.
So, Clement, help us set the stage.
Okay, cool. So the conversation that, we selected that topic because that's something that we are being asked quite often. With Ad Badger, the software, users can set up calls with us and have some strategy meetings. So that happens a lot. Like some people are migrating from another solution to our solution. They are taking things in-house and they want to understand how to better control their PPC. And control means better structure. That's something that needs to happen. So that's why we wanted to really take that opportunity, onboarding a new client that has a complicated structure, something that really need to be dusted out, and make a case study out of that. So the I always like to start asking the clients to really tell me what was the approach, what did he try, the successes and the failure to really kickstart my experiments. I don't want to, you know, fall back into what they already did if they failed. And I want to capitalize on their successes, obviously.
Yeah. You know, I'm curious too about the, and for context, you know, this is still early in the relationship, right? So you're like, you're getting to know this person, you're getting to know this product. And as a PPC manager, like, how important is it to, like, how important is that history? Like, what do you do with it? Like, was there anything that you learned that was actually helpful? Because, you know, we send out onboarding forms, questionnaires and whatnot to like try to probe some of that history. I do it too on my PPC coaching calls. I'm just like, so how have you managed it? What do you think the biggest problem is? What has gone well? What hasn't gone well? Like, was there anything here that you were able to sort of learn, or like, what did you find valuable about it?
Yeah, I did. So he was doing an okay job of managing it himself. He tried some other agency, didn't work out. He was not unhappy with the results. Yeah, so he tried to really outsource the PPC because it's a big account. Okay, so we are talking several grands per week of spend per product. So it's it has significant size, and the size and the category is very competitive. So yeah, wanted some help, you know, improving upon things. So before that, it's clear that what happened is it's been passed on so many times that the structure is just, it has been patched, and the intent of the campaigns has been lost, and there was like, it was going all over the place. We end up with one campaign with more than 6,000 keywords inside. So several ad groups, you know, limited with 1,000 keywords per ad group, which is already too many. And yeah, they build up upon that. So that's the biggest issue that I see with that account. And that was the result of the conversation I had with him. On top of that.
It's wild. Oh, go ahead.
No, on top of that, the conversation I am having with them as well is really to understand what the product is trying to solve, because that goes to the second part of the analysis, the market analysis, the, you know, the product analysis. I need to really know what I'm going to sell it well, right?
Mm-hmm. Like, what keyword's going to be relevant? What negative keyword will be irrelevant? That kind of thing.
Exactly. Because, you know, you can go after so many rabbits. Is that a thing you say?
Yeah. Rabbit holes. That's not a thing in France.
Yeah, you know, you're chasing rabbits, not rabbit holes.
Yes.
You're not going down the rabbit holes. But you have to focus on, you know, what really solve the...
It's almost hard to find the problem. It's almost hard to find the problem a lot in PPC. Like, why are things the way that it is? And, you know, you mentioned data too. Like, let's actually talk about the problem, right? I think so much in PPC is about forward progress. Like, how do we assume that every number in our account is wrong and assume we can make it better? So even if you have what you consider a good ACoS, there should be like this impulse to say, let's pretend it's bad. Like, how do we make this even better? How do we improve volume more? How do we, you know, what's our next move? I think like never being satisfied is sort of inherent in PPC. So, you know, you mentioned data. Let's talk about the history of this product a little bit. And again, we're recording on November 10th. So like next episode, we'll have what happened. So this particular product has a total ACoS. We'll start at the very, very top. Total ACoS of 25.4%. And it has, you know, a product ACoS of 53%. And it has about 5,000 PPC orders in the time frame that we're looking at. And we'll have graphs to go along with this as well. So click on the link in the description to see some of this data and follow along with this. So the product, you know, conversion rate 15%, you know, total ACoS 25%, you know, it's not awful. It's not out of this world bad. Like, you know, 25% total ACoS is pretty high. That's probably above average, but I'm curious, like, you know, we want to improve this. We want to make it better. So I guess, what did you glean from, like, doing that history, that the history, the market analysis, the competitive analysis, like, what did you do with regards to, like, market analysis or product analysis? Like, if you were to sort of outline the steps, like, think back and, like, what were those steps and, like, what did you get from those steps?
Yeah, sure. So, like you said, when you take that 10,000 feet view, things are not looking too bad, but when and you could be satisfied with that, but now you need to scratch the surface and see all the thing that could be improved. The first thing I started was campaign naming. So we have our naming convention, and that makes screening a lot easier. So one good thing is that he was targeting one product per campaign, which makes things easier for us to really segregate that data and our baseline. Yes, yes. First thing to do, you know, have that good naming conversion in place. So we can really understand what's the intent of the campaigns and use the filters.
It was actually great because when we started talking about this, you're just like, oh, okay, like, I have a great example of something to talk about. You're like, just type this ASIN into the search box and boom, exactly. I saw the campaign that you were talking about. So, like,
exactly.
For communication, collaboration. And I also think too, like, people say, like, well, what's good campaign naming even matter? I'm not working with anybody else. You have to work with your future self. Like, you might think it makes sense in this moment, but, like, in 3 weeks from now, 6 months from now, a year from now, you want easily searchable campaign names. So for sure, campaign naming, love that you did that. By the way, how did you do that? Did you do a bulk upload? Were there too many for you to do it manually in the interface? What path did you take to do that?
Oh yeah, that's a big account. So bulk upload it is. Like, it's saving so much time. It's quite easy to use, actually. Like, it's frightening, but you have to take it one step at a time. And
yes, we should include a link to an episode Brent and I did talking about bulk uploads, campaign naming. We talk about how to name a campaign. We talk about how to upload it in a bulk file. So that should be really helpful for people. We'll link to that.
For sure, yeah. Step-by-step process. Right. So yeah, first thing, take a deep dive, understand what's the intent of each campaigns after being renamed, and then market analysis. Look at the competitors, look at your product, and then do a clean keyword research. And that's important to do it at that stage to preserve the naivety that we have when we onboard the client, because down the road, then we're going to lose that and we will not be able to have those fresh eyes, removing all the experienced eyes that we'll gain.
For sure. You know, I think there's something so valuable in those first few weeks or first few months about working in an account. And you're absolutely right. Like, you almost want to maintain those fresh eyes. Like, you know, we always say, like, oh, the power of having some fresh eyes in there. So, like, doing keyword research as if the account is brand new, I think is really valuable. It's because you can do, like, gap analysis where, like, oh, okay, like, these are keywords that we have. These are things that we're indexed for. These are keywords that we're bidding on. And then, like, compare it to, like, oh, I just did keyword research without that knowledge of what it currently is. I did new research on new keywords and, like, new data now. And I'm actually have a different list. And you can see where, you know, there's new ideas for you to go after, which I think is huge. So, like, you know, one thing I think is true for anybody, having someone in your professional network to come and give your account a look over of just like, oh, you didn't notice this. Like, check that out. Because no PPC account is perfect, ever. it can always be improved. Even a good thing could become great, right? So like nothing is ever perfect. And a great thing could become even more great. Like you can always push it forward. So a lot of times having a fresh set of eyes come in there is super helpful. So, you know, it's so valuable. You know, internally here at AppBadger, we do that. We are like, hey, can someone come take a look at this account with me? I just want a set of fresh eyes, like doing these like quick campaign audits.
Yeah.
I love it.
100%. Yeah.
Yeah. There's also the power of like experienced eyes of just like, oh, I've been in the account so long. I know where everything is going. I know what everything is doing. So like, I think the best conversations come through like when you've been in an account for like 6 months, a year plus, and you're talking to somebody who's like brand new, who's coming into like, with a fresh pair of eyes, and you can combine your perspectives. Like, I think when we were talking about like the client experiences, like that's the kind of thing that we look for. And yeah, PPC, it's really hard because a lot of times, sometimes people don't know why things are the way that they are, that have been working in an account for a long time. So like having the different perspectives can be so valuable.
Yeah, so, yeah.
Yeah, and clean keyword research.
Yeah, and I just want to add that, you know, even though we have our own SOPs and processes, we all have our own touch, right? So having those cross-auditing sessions makes the experience so much richer and can really outline some new strategies. So that was great sharing stuff.
Yeah, which is so true about like the it's like the downside of an SOP. Because it's like, you know, if everyone in your company is doing everything exactly the same, there's going to be a lot of missed opportunity. Like if you're just making everybody follow this very rigid SOP and you don't allow for some creativity, there's going to be a lot of missed opportunity because like, you know, technically like nobody has very experienced eyes and nobody has fresh eyes. You're just sort of like have SOP eyes. You're just like following a process, which could be good and bad.
Double-edged sword. For sure. So yeah, you're going to miss, you're going to follow that blindly. You're not going to look, you know, think outside the box, because sometimes, you know, you're faced with a problem that is not included in that SOP. And while we are enriching them every time we are facing a new one, then, you know, you need that, that extra thinking to be able to face a new challenge and overcome it.
Yes. So Clement, so far up until this point, we haven't done anything to change performance, right? We had a conversation with a client. We did some market analysis, competitive analysis, learned about the product. We did some campaign renaming so we can find it easier. We did some keyword research. By the way, how did you do keyword research? Like what tools did you use or things like that?
Yeah, well, I'm using Helium 10. Yeah. And to do reverse ASIN analysis.
Reverse ASIN, yeah.
Yeah, sure. I'm also, you know, using all the search term reports that Amazon provides us. The search query performance is a great source of opportunity and understanding product. It's great. Mansoor did a lot of work on this one. He has a great template. Yeah, I know he's a friend of the show, so a great episode that you did with him a while back. It's super, super helpful. And it's just a mix of all these things while also spending some time in the product detail page, because you know the copy needs to be good. You have to read it thoroughly. You understand what it does. Yes. And you have a lot of keywords there as well. So
epic. So far, I love your approach so far, because, you know, Clement, you might not know, there's an American hero, Abraham Lincoln, and he's got this great quote, which is, if you give me 5 hours to chop down a tree, I'll spend the first three sharpening the saw. And that sounds like exactly what you've done up until this point. You've organized the campaign name so they're easy to find, easy to scan, easy to work with. You've done some fresh keyword research to wrap your head around the market. You've taken a look at some competitors to get a sense of everything. You've had conversations with the client to try to understand the history and what's working well and what can be improved. You've got the data here. You know, we've got a 15% total, a 25% total ACOS. We haven't actually done anything yet. We haven't actually like done PPC work. So the question here is, what did you decide to do here? Like, are you changing budgets? Are you, you know, moving keywords, pausing things, adding negatives, adding new keywords to these campaigns? I know that you mentioned I mentioned at the start of the show, there's a 6,000 keyword campaign where was the majority of traffic starting there. Like, what clued you in that campaign structure is like the thing to do here?
So the first thing I'm doing is that I isolate branded keywords because, you know, they are lost in all that craziness of campaigns and they muddy the water. So again, if I look at a high surface level view, I see that campaign, it's performing well. Why should I change that, right? Because it's fine the way it is. But whenever you really investigate everything, you see that the branded keywords are obviously converting the best. And it's sometimes they take most of the budget, sometimes not, but they're just messing things at the surface level. So we wanted to really isolate them, branded keywords, the own async targeting as well, you know, all that good stuff on all ad types, and then begin the work of really peeling out what could be done. But we needed to make sure that we were not going to nuke the account. We want to preserve sales velocity, momentum, and that's the hardest part. On top of that, we had to work with the budget limits because that would be very easy to just, you know, start new campaigns and then build on top of that. And it's the easiest approach. And then you see what works, what doesn't work, and then you close down things down the road. But we have to work with that as well. So what I did is I'm leaving the keywords that are driving most of the sales in the origin campaign because the campaigns have a historical data. They are performing the way they do thanks to that historical data. And Amazon likes that. The algorithm likes that. I'm peeling out the keywords that I identified as being good opportunities, meaning that they have high conversion, potentially lower ACoS than average. And I'm giving them their own budget, their own campaigns. I want to test them out. I want to see if they can flourish with a lot of breathing room. And that's the end game. And then I'm going to peel things out again and again until everything looks clean, that I'm confident that all the keywords that I'm targeting are getting enough attention and they are properly tested.
Amazing.
It's a marathon.
Yeah. I would definitely say go back, hit the rewind 30 seconds, hit the rewind 30 seconds twice to get all of that. But I'm going to try to paraphrase it here. So when you have a campaign with 6,000 keywords, like what would you say, what percentage of them were actually getting more than 10 clicks a month?
Yeah. And the thing is that it's not as easy as checking one ad group because remember they were in different ad groups. So you have to travel back and forth. Mm-hmm. So 10 clicks, look, what percentage? Like what? Less than 1%. We all know that. Like,
so it always looks like, it always looks the same because it's like top keyword gets like 70% of the sales and clicks. Second keyword gets like another 10. Maybe the next one gets another like 8%. And then by the time you get to like keyword number 100 in the ad, in the campaign, now all of a sudden it's like, well, that the 100th keyword gets maybe one click, maybe. And then by the time, so like the fact that there were 6,000 in a single campaign represents, you know, whatever we want to call it. Maybe we should start calling it like ad group algorithmic suppression, where you just like, for whatever reason, when you have that many keywords in an ad group, they just don't flourish. They just don't have the room to breathe. And like from a, you know, budget perspective, it doesn't make sense to have something that gets 100 orders a month right next to in the same ad group as something that gets one order a month. So I started seeing a lot of people, not a lot of people, But I've started seeing this approach where like people are segmenting campaigns based off the search volume of the keyword. And like, mm-hmm. that's kind of the right idea that you want. Mm-hmm. You know, you want groups of keywords behaving mostly similarly. That way, like your top of search that gets applied to the 10 keywords in it is going to be reasonable for all 10. That way, like the budget that you have for all 10 keywords is going to be reasonable for all 10 keywords, which is why I always say like, you know, like the hard and fast rule of like following an SOP, like every ad group must have less than 10 keywords. Well, actually, like you could have a keyword that gets 1,000 orders a week next to a keyword that gets one order a month. And like, that doesn't make sense, even though you just have 10. I've mentioned this exactly. before on the show. I'm getting deja vu. So like, that's the approach. And like, you know, you don't nuke it, right? You don't pause that campaign. You grab some things and move it somewhere else. So starting with exactly. the least important keywords, so that you maintain historical performance the best you can, and that you're only focused on, you know, new opportunity as opposed to doing things with longstanding winners. When you transfer those things, like what are your thoughts on like what bids do you set for those new keywords? Like, how do you think about that?
Yeah, so budgets, I'm in that specific case, I talk with the clients and that's something I'm completely open and transparent with. So I'm reserving 10% of that the daily budget for that product to testing out, and it needs to be significant because we want to have that minimum amount. We don't want to just gather one clicks every now and then. We really want to test things out, and we don't want to be stalling. Like, it needs to happen. But yeah, that's I'm allocating a part of that budget to testing things out. And what was the second part of your question?
How you think about the bidding for these things?
Oh, too. Yeah, sure. So if I have some clicks already, I have an idea of the CPC. So I can start with that, right? Average CPC. And then I'm just entering that. I can also start with the suggested bids. Often Amazon likes to overshoot the suggested bids. And when you take things back a couple of days after after starting the new campaign, you often see that your CPC is actually lower than the bid they suggested, right? So but you know, it gives you a starting point if you don't have anything to work with. Otherwise, I make sure that I can get at the very least 10 clicks per keywords per day with my allocated budget. And that's basic yep. math, right? Yeah, you want to give the keywords that opportunity at the very least. So if you have, quick example, if you have a $10 budget and a $5 bid, that doesn't make sense. You're going to get max 2 clicks. That's you need to adjust that.
Yeah. So the stage has been set and the game is afoot. Do you think, like, what is going, so you started this campaign restructuring maybe a couple of days ago or so. The question, yeah. Another question that a lot of people have is like, you could theoretically restructure this 6,000 keyword campaign in a day, just mm-hmm. like completely nuke it, upload it, you know, do it in a spreadsheet, and then upload your desired structure. You haven't done that. You're sort of doing it piecewise. Number one, what's the advantage of that? Are you just being lazy?
On the contrary, the lazy approach would be to pause everything, you know, group the campaigns in, group the keywords per 10, right, and re-upload it. Right? It would be mm-hmm. pretty right. easy. What would happen? Your budget would skyrocket. Your thing would be out of control. Your sales would probably go down just because you're going after all these opportunities. I imagine, I have that in my head, like, campaigns running out of budget all the time, you're missing opportunities, and it's going to take a long, like, ranking drops, organic sales down, tacos increase mm-hmm. through the roof. I don't want that. I want the transition to happen, but I want to control it. So, got yeah.
it. Yeah, so doing it slow and piecewise, it allows you to make really methodical changes for sure.
Exactly.
So how are you feeling right now? Like, do you think you will be able to maybe beat a tacos of 25%. Do you think you'll be able to beat you know, the current level of PPC sales and, you know, or PPC orders and all those good things?
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. Having better control means that you can focus on what works, what you can identify, what doesn't, optimize as, you know, to the best of your abilities. I'm going to improve on things. Yeah, that's why I'm here.
Awesome. Yes. And, you know, part of the show too is like looking at the real deal data. Like sometimes you do best practice and like maybe it takes a little longer than expected, or maybe it requires a couple extra steps. And like, I think next week's that, well, again, we're going to record it a couple weeks from now, but it will be the next episode the person hears. I think that's going to be a really cool opportunity to like actually have that conversation about like all of everything that we talked about at this episode, like is like universally true. Like, should you have a campaign with 6,000 keywords? No. Like, should you do, you know, market analysis and learn the history and do campaign naming and like do fresh keyword research and like do this restructuring in the way that we've talked about? The answer is yes, 1,000%. And I think one cool thing we're doing with the podcast now is like, well, let's do all those things. And like, let's actually talk about what happened, like real deal data. So in the notes here, we will have a link to like the sort of like quote unquote results. So like you can follow along in the next week, the next episode, we will sort of go deeper and talk about like, hey, did this end up panning out? Like, what did you have to do about it? Like what first happened, what happened next? And like really touch on what it's like to actually manage a PPC campaign and like how you're reacting to the data that you're getting. I'm stoked for it. And thanks for opening up the kimono, so to speak, and sort of taking us along on this journey.
Yeah, for sure. You're welcome to ride along with me. I like that.
The ride along, yes. Well, Clement, thank you so much for coming on the show. We will meet again in a couple weeks. Like I mentioned, today's November 10th. We'll meet again and record the part two of this, and that will be released for you, dear listener, in the next episode. So, Clement, have a good one, and I will talk to you soon.
Yeah, see you. Thanks, Mike.